Okay. Good morning. Well, I am in mourning this morning. I was going to wear my gabardine, my black gabardine morning suit, but OSU lost yesterday. And
by inches.
It was by inches in the last 30 seconds. Quiet now. Yeah, they deserve to lose, but it's still very sad. So be nice to me today. The doctor has given me bed rest requirements for the rest of this week. All righty. It is wonderful to see you today. Lyndon, can people hear me? Can you hear me back there, Liz? I don't think they can hear me over here. So we need to... I'll try to get this down here. Is that better? Okay. Hi, Alicia. You brought two new friends today. I'm so glad to see you. All righty. We are looking at the book of Revelation. And last week we studied and introduced the chapter of Revelation 11, which are the two witnesses. And we're going to finish that today. We're finishing page 195 from last week. And we're also going to attempt to finish page 196. Next week, listen carefully. We will be studying, and I will be introducing chapter 12 of the book of Revelation. Chapter 12 is an introduction to us. Well, it's really not an introduction, but it is one of the best chapters on the study of Satan, chapter 12. So start reading that, because I will take you back into the book of Isaiah and into the book of Ezekiel. And throughout the New Testament on the study of Satan. And unless you understand all of that, you won't really understand the book, the chapter 12 of Revelation. So again, as you know, I do a lot of detours. And so next week we're going to detour into the Old Testament to study the character of Satan and from where he came. And how evil did come into the world. So we're today, however, we're on page 196 and 197. Lavonda, can you hear me better now?
Yeah.
Okay. Listen, Christ is risen.
Risen indeed.
Jesus is alive. And Jesus is coming for his church.
Very soon.
Good. All right. Now, Revelation chapter 1, verse 3 is the Beatitudes of the book of Revelation. But as you read Revelation, you will be finding more Beatitudes. Beatitudes are the blessings that are given to us through the study and the reading of the book of Revelation. Ready? Blessed. Shall we do that one again? Blessed. And I want you to know, as people listen to our YouTube and they hear this class doing these, it sounds really good. So you're performing now for YouTube. And blessed
are those who hear.
And blessed
are those who
because
the time is near.
That's right. The time is near. These are the Beatitudes. These are the blessings that are promised to us as we study the book of Revelation. We will be blessed when we read it aloud. We are blessed when we hear it read, and we are blessed when we believe it, because the time is near. And that is God's promise to us. All right. Whoops, wait. Go back. Okay. If you would, open your Bibles. Oh, wait a minute. Lyndon, I want you to go back there, and we're going to practice fading out, okay? Because this is one of our songs. Because the Bible tells us that we are blessed when we read the book of Revelation. And I always say to people when we read this kind of prophecy, but until then, what do we do? Until that day that the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. when Jesus comes again, what are we to do? And we are to stand on what we believe. And here is what we believe. Now, I've got to tell you something. The beautiful songs that we sing, sometimes they're 8 to 10 minutes on the YouTube. So Lyndon and I are practicing something. He's going to, what'd you call it?
Fade out.
After we have heard the major part of this song. So you fade it when you're ready, darling. Okay. All right, until then. That's it. That's the one I want.
In this time of desperation, all we know is doubt and fear. There is only one foundation.
What do we believe?
We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and He's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that He conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and He's coming back.
Beautiful. And you know, I ask you, as we have studied this and as we've studied the martyrs, be sure that you know what your testimony is. Be ready to stand on the testimony. And this is what we as believers in this class believe. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe in the resurrection. We believe that He conquered death, and we believe that He's coming back again. We believe, and we stand on that. We will not recant those beliefs. Now, I do have something I want to share with you this morning, that this is a notebook from Pastor Rob, and these are where you're going to be taking your notes in church this morning. So be sure and get this. And I really love taking notes. So here is my book of notes. I keep it in my Bible. And it started April 19th, 2015. So sometimes I forget to take notes. But It's all the way through. And I also put in here the songs that really speak to me on Sunday morning. So we've been singing We Believe. And then there's another one that's called, I can't remember the name of it. But it's about I Can't Wait for Eternity. That is when we are going to be singing Holy, 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 forever and ever. And that's the song we sang last week, and it's on our YouTube as well. I'll let you listen to it sometime. So be sure and take notes on Sunday morning, because Pastor does a lot of wonderful teachings, and he really corroborates a lot that we do in here. Or maybe I should say I corroborate what he says. I'm not sure who comes first. Terry?
Also a daily Bible study.
Oh, really?
On every aspect of God, love, forgiveness, how to give. The daily Bible study and with scriptures to read and questions to answer. Was that incredible?
That's really good. Thank you, Terry. Thank you for bringing me mine. Okay. All right. Today we're studying the two witnesses of Revelation 11. Last week as we read this, I know one of your first questions was, when did these two witnesses appear? According to the scriptures, it doesn't say exactly. There are many people who disagree on it when the exact time that these two witnesses appear. But I think it's somewhere in the middle of the tribulation. And the second question is, who are those two witnesses? Who will they be? And so last week we studied Zerubbabel and Joshua from Zechariah 4, because during a very dark time, they were the light to the world. And what was the power given to Joshua and Zerubbabel so that they could stand as light in a very dark world? What was their power? The power of the Holy Spirit. And it was represented by those olive trees. So as you listen today, listen to the scriptures where John is comparing the olive tree and the candlelight to Zerubbabel and Joshua. Because just as they stood in a very dark time, they were empowered by God's Holy Spirit to be the light of the world. And so we do know that is why some people say, well, these two witnesses in the book of Revelation are Zerubbabel and Joshua. Other people say Elijah and John the Baptist. And these are in your notes, by the way, on your YouTube from last week. And they're in your notes on page 196. But I'm just kind of going through this quickly. Most people say, well, I shouldn't say most people. Many people say Elijah and Enoch. One person said, well, we don't know, but I can tell you for sure they're not Elijah and Moses. I mean, you know, it's just really interesting to study everybody and what their notes, what their reasoning behind it. And they can convince me. Every one of them can convince me as to who these men are. Somebody came up to me last week and said, well, I heard that it was Elijah and Melchizedek. When you study the Old Testament, you meet a man named Melchizedek. He was a prophet and a king before Israel was ever established. And the scriptures tell us in the book of Psalms and in the book of Hebrews that there was no beginning and no end to this man, Melchizedek. So people say, well, I think then it's Elijah and Melchizedek. Other people have told me just this week that some people say it is Elijah and perhaps John the Revelator himself. And we can be convinced on every one of them. Some people say they're just regular old folks who just showed up one day and God used them to be the light of the very dark world. The scriptures can also say, if you just look at Revelation chapter 11, says these two witnesses are the Word of God and the Holy Spirit. It just tells us right there. Perhaps that's what it means. I looked up what the Mormons say about the two witnesses in the book of Revelation. Of course, they say Joseph Smith is one and his brother. We really want to respect these people. So Hiram Smith, his brother. Now, that's who they say. And so then the Baha'i faith, that's a Middle Eastern faith that's very prevalent here in the United States. They say Muhammad, the founder of Islam, and another man named Ali, who was the son of an Islamic Arab leader in the 8th or 9th century. So isn't it interesting? It could just be, I mean, people just have all kinds of ideas. So what does that tell us when we, can we get dogmatic about these two people?
Nope.
No, because you see, dogma could lead to truth, and we got to be really careful that we don't become dogmatic about the things that the scriptures don't tell us. But we do need to know what about them. We know that they were men. We know that there were two of them. And now today, what we're going to do as we listen to the passage is I want you to listen to the things they could do, because they had supernatural powers. These were very, very powerful men. One day in Jerusalem, during the tribulation, they show up. And they're wearing sackcloth, and which represents mourning and repentance, and they just start preaching. And the scriptures say prophesying. And what we know is that they preached on Jesus Christ, the Messiah that Jerusalem, that Israel had rejected. We know that these men are going to be bringing up all of the judgments that they've been facing and say, look, this is God bringing judgment upon Israel and upon the world for the rejection of his son, Jesus Christ. And then they're going to say, but these aren't the only judgments that are going to happen. There are going to be many more, and it will be much worse. And I want you to listen then at the response of the people around the world. And that will be kind of interesting. So all of this is on page 196. And we're going to, you can fill that out if you listen to the lesson on YouTube from last week. So please turn in your Bible to Revelation 11. And we're going to hear a beautiful reading of chapter 11. And Brenda, would you tell me again who you said this person is? Inspector Perot on what? On Agatha Christie. This is the one who's reading this. I thought you would like to know that. Brenda has my trivia. Thank you, Brenda. All right, so we're in page Revelation 11. And we're going to ask God, because he promised us that as we read this and as we hear it, we will be what?
Blessed.
So let's listen to this. Honey, would you make sure this is turned up as loudly as possible, please? And then turn it back down. This is Inspector Perot reading the scriptures to us.
Revelation chapter 11.
Thank you.
I was given a reed like a measuring rod and was told, go and measure the temple of God and the altar with its worshippers, but exclude the outer court. Do not measure it, because it has been given to the Gentiles. They will trample on the holy city for 42 months, and I will appoint my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. They are the two olive trees and the two lampstands, and they stand before the Lord of the earth. If anyone tries to harm them, fire comes from their mouths and devours their enemies. This is how anyone who wants to harm them must die. They have power to shut up the heavens so that it will not rain during the time they are prophesying, and they have power to turn the waters into blood and to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they want. Now when they have finished their testimony, the beast that comes up from the abyss will attack them and overpower and kill them. Their bodies will lie in the public square of the great city, which is figuratively called Sodom and Egypt, where also their Lord was crucified. For 3.5 days, some from every people, tribe, language, and nation will gaze on their bodies and refuse them burial. The inhabitants of the earth will gloat over them and will celebrate by sending each other gifts, because these two prophets had tormented those who live on the earth. But after the 3.5 days, the breath of life from God entered them, and they stood on their feet, and terror struck those who saw them. Then they heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, "Come up here." And they went up to heaven in a cloud, while their enemies looked on. At that very hour, there was a severe earthquake, and a tenth of the city collapsed. 7,000 people were killed in the earthquake, and the survivors were terrified and gave glory to the God of heaven. The second woe has passed. The third woe is coming soon.
That's pretty scary, isn't it? I moved my microphone. Can you hear me better? Okay. So let's look at now these miracles that these men performed. How many days did they prophesy? 3.5 years. How many days is that? That's verse 3. 1,260 days. How many months is that? Now, here is one reason that, and I think it's a very legitimate reason, that people say this happened at the end of the last 3.5 years of the tribulation, is because whenever Daniel speaks of 3.5 years or 42 months, it's always the second half of the 7-year tribulation. So John is just continuing it in his book. So let's look at the miracles that they performed. This is page 196. These men would perform miracles, and it would demonstrate God's coming judgment. He's already told them about the 7 seals of the judgments that God has already brought onto the world. And now he's telling them that their miracles will demonstrate God's judgment, coming judgment. Number 1, verses 5 and 6, these miracles are like Elijah. And this is why many, many people say that these men are, one of them is Elijah. So let's look at, and you can find all of this in 1 Kings chapter 18. These miracles that reflect that of Elijah. Death. If anyone, this is verse 5 in your book and in your notes, at the bottom of page 196, if anyone tries to harm them, fire comes from their mouth and devours their enemies. And then he says, this is how anyone who wants to harm them must what?
Die.
So their miracles result in death of unbelievers, particularly those people who are persecuting these men. And so you can imagine in Jerusalem at these men as they begin to testify to the judgment of God, the people got angrier and angrier. You read a lot of novels about this time, and they are just bombarded with apples and rotten tomatoes and rotten eggs. You know, they're just hit, and then they're mocked, and they're tormented, and they're jeered at. Well, if it happens, then these people have the power to destroy those unbelievers with what?
Fire.
Coming out of their mouths. Now, that would be a pretty powerful thing, wouldn't it? And then secondly, they could bring drought upon the earth. Now, Elijah was able to bring drought upon Israel for as long as he wished, and he wished it to be how long, Elijah?
3 years.
3.5 years. 3.5 years. That's exactly what Elijah did. And then it was during the time of King Ahab. And Elijah, at the end of the 3.5 years, was praying, and he sent his servant, and he said, go look and see if you see a cloud. And eventually, one of his servant came back and said, I see something. It's maybe a cloud. It's about the size of a hand. And that was the sign that it was going to become raining again. But these men have that same power to bring drought upon the earth. Verse 6 says, they have power to shut up the heavens so that it will not rain during the time they are prophesying. How long did these men prophesy?
3.5 years.
So they could make it dry, not rain, for 3.5 years. Wouldn't that be frightening? I mean, you can know how hot August is in Oklahoma when we don't get rain. There's cracks in the ground and everything's dried up. This is for 3.5 years that they are prophesying that it did not rain. So let's look at the bottom of page 196, letter D, number 1. They perform mighty what?
Miracles.
And they perform these miracles to show the world what God's judgment will be like. First miracles they did are the miracles like those of whom?
Elijah.
If anyone tries to harm them, what?
Fire
comes from their mouths and devours their enemies. This is how anyone who wants to harm these witnesses must what?
Die.
And that's pretty scary. Letter B, the drought. They have power to shut up the what?
Heavens
so that it will not rain during the times they are prophesying. And how long will that be? Okay, now the second set of miracles that they can do are similar to those of Moses. And so let's look at how these miracles reflect Moses. Exodus chapter 7 through 11, you can read about these miracles that Moses brought upon Egypt. And verse 6b, they, the witnesses, have power to turn their waters into blood. Did Moses do that?
Yes,
he did that. And to strike the earth with every kind of plague as often as they want. What kind of plagues did Moses bring upon the earth in upon Egypt in Exodus 7? Well, that was the last one.
Frogs.
Frogs.
Locusts.
Lice. Ooh.
Darkness.
Bloody waters.
Thunderbolts
and hail. Destroyed all of Egypt. Boils. Were there boils in that one? Okay. So go back and look at those plagues that Moses brought upon Egypt. And it's the same thing that these men can do. They can bring plagues, but not just upon Egypt and on Israel, but the whole what?
World.
The whole world. They can bring plagues upon the whole world as often as they want. So what plagues did Moses bring upon Egypt? You'll find that in Exodus 7. And how will these plagues be different from those of which Moses brought? They'll be upon the entire earth, whereas Moses's was just focused on what country?
Egypt,
that's right. So let's look at letter D, number 2. These are the miracles similar to whom?
Moses.
They have power to turn the waters into
blood,
and that's what happened, the Nile River. The only water source that Egypt really has was turned into blood. And they have the power to strike the earth with every kind of what?
Plague
as they want. Now, you and I think of plagues like COVID, but these plagues are other kinds of natural disasters that we just discussed. And it could be worldwide. Now then, let's look now at how they were hated. These men were hated. Would you not think they would be if they could bring frogs into your home and lice into your hair? They were hated. And so they were abused. And so what did Jesus, I want to remind you of this, because this is what Jesus is going to say is more common that happens to his believers than what you and I are experiencing today. You and I are experiencing very little persecution, no persecution for our beliefs, right? But Jesus said, people are going to do this if you follow me. He said, If the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. And he tells us that the world will hate us. The world can persecute us. And then he said, but don't be afraid. I'll never leave you. Isn't that wonderful? So here he's telling these witnesses knew this when they followed Jesus, that the world was going to hate them. And then the two witnesses were not only hated, but then they were assassinated. They were murdered. And we're going to find that it was the Antichrist who had them killed. So they were murdered. Here's what Jesus said about this. He said, the people can, you will be hated just like they hated me. And then he said, and you could be murdered, but do not be afraid of those who can kill the body. Does that make sense to you? Does it make sense to you that we don't fear people who could kill us? It doesn't make sense to me, really. I would be afraid if someone's going to try to kill me. But he's saying, in a spiritual way, do not be afraid of those who will kill the body. I have been reading my book, Fox's Book of Martyrs. Have you gotten it all read yet, Steve?
No.
No, it takes a long time because you can only take a little bit about from Fox's Book of Martyrs. And it's a whole history of the martyrs who have followed Jesus Christ. And throughout Europe, throughout the Middle East. And it's interesting for me, I try to mark it in my book as I read this. What do these people say as they are going to get their head cut off? What do these people say as they're going to be burned alive at the stake? What are they saying? And you know, it'll be words like this. Father, I trust in Jesus Christ to keep his promises, that I will see him in heaven. And then the book will say, and then they put on the crown of the martyr. And we have to know the scriptures. Otherwise, we cannot at all do what Jesus said when we face martyrdom. Because he said, don't be afraid of those. And these people in the Fox's Book of Martyrs go so willingly, so bravely to this place of martyrdom. And don't fear those who will kill your body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Who is that?
God.
Satan. Satan is the one who can kill both your body and your soul in hell. That's the one we fear. We don't fear that person who can just kill the body. Because our soul goes directly to heaven, doesn't it? And these people in this Fox's Book of Martyrs stand strong in the face of torment because they know that their soul will be with Christ. And that's what Jesus wants us to do. These men in the Book of Revelation faced martyrdom. These witnesses were indestructible. This is what I find so interesting. These witnesses were indestructible. They could shoot at them, probably did, trying to kill them, but nothing happened to them because they were indestructible until the scriptures tell us their work was completed. God had a job for them. They did it. They stood strong, and they survived every attack until their work was completed. Angela?
What you said doesn't make sense to me about Satan being able to kill our soul.
In hell.
If we're not saved.
Be ended up in hell.
If we're not saved.
If you're not saved.
So not like.
I'm not afraid of Satan.
Okay.
I'm told not to fear Satan.
Well, I'm just wanting you to see what Jesus said here. He's making a contrast, and you're right. He's contrasting here. If you're facing martyrdom, don't fear those people who are going, can kill your body. But he's saying to us, if we're not believers, there is someone who can kill not only your body, but your soul. And where will your soul be destroyed? In hell. That's what he's telling people. Not us as believers, but he's telling the whole world. Don't be afraid unless that one can kill your body and your soul. And that's Satan. Yes, Pat?
I have a question here.
Okay, real loud, baby.
I thought people that go to
It's a figure of speech, I think. We're not to take this as doctrine. What we're saying is, you're going to hell. That's what we're thinking about. You're going to hell.
What is death? Death is separation.
From God.
Separation from God is right. What happens in eternal hell.
That's right.
And that's what makes it as bad as it is.
Yes.
There is no hope. There is no God.
No hope. Can you imagine? Can you imagine eternity without hope?
No.
Can you imagine? Because that's how we live today. We live with the great hope, don't we? So, my point here is that these men prophesied for 3.5 years. They faced danger every day, but until their work was done, they couldn't be destroyed physically. That's true of you and me too. God is not going to call us home to heaven until our work on earth is done. Isn't that interesting? And He won't, because He has a job for us, and all of our days are written in a book. And it says right here that their work was not completed. Until their work was completed, they were indestructible. Let's read that verse. It's verse 7. Now when they, and who are they?
The
witnesses. Always when you see a pronoun, go back to see to whom it's referring. When they, the witnesses, have finished their testimony, and God is going to be finished with me someday, and He will take me home. Now, I've told Him I've got a lot of teaching yet to do, and so I don't know how long I'm going to have to live a couple hundred years to finally get to the 400 years between the testaments, aren't I? But see, God said, when your work is done. Paul said the same thing, didn't he? I have fought the good fight. I have completed my work. And when that happens, they come home. When they have finished their testimony, the beast, look at these words, the beast. We will find in chapter 13 that the beast is the Antichrist. Okay? There is the beast from the sea and the beast from the earth. This is the beast from the sea, the Antichrist. When they, the witnesses, have finished their testimony, the Antichrist that comes up from the abyss. The abyss is not really today. It's different kind of a word than hell, but we're not going to get into this today because it's a major study. But when it talks about the abyss, it's the place where Satan and his demons abide. Remember when we look into the seals, the judgment seals, the abyss is opened and smoke comes out and millions of demons come out of that abyss. Remember that? In one of the judgments, seal judgments. So here we have the beast that comes up from the abyss will attack them. Attack meaning the witnesses. We know that the Antichrist is controlled by Satan, and that's what it's telling us here. He will attack them and overpower them and kill them. So how long is their testimony where they're indestructible?
3.5 years.
This is the first of 36 references in the book of Revelation to the Antichrist, to the beast. And so from now on, when you read about the beast, think of the Antichrist, and because there will be 36 more times you will read about him, and it's the Antichrist, the first of 36, and the abyss is where Satan and his demons reside. So let's look at page 100, where are we? 96, letter E, the martyrdom of these witnesses is the very bottom of page 196. They were indestructible, letter E, until what? Until their testimony was finished, or until their work was finished. They are indestructible until they have finished their work. Verse 7, number 1, when they have finished their testimony, how many years is that? The beast, who is that? The Antichrist. This is the first of how many references to the Antichrist? Good. He comes up from where? The abyss. Now, I put hell there. Please mark that out because I don't think that's the right word. I'm not going to get into that right now because I think I'm incorrect on that. But it's the place where Satan and his demons reside. And he will what?
Attack
them. overpower them, and kill them. Okay? So let's find next, verse 8, number 2 on the next page. We're going to find why they were so hated. Verse number 2, verse 8, page 197. The world hated these two witnesses because of their testimony, because of those miracles that they wrought upon the world, and because of their power. So let's look at that. They were hated because of their testimony. They were hated because of their power. And what did I tell you? Oh, their miracles, which is pretty much the same thing as their power. Look what happened to them when they were killed. Now, we don't know how they're killed, do we? Now, when you read Timothy Hay, and who wrote the books?
LaHaye.
He has them being shot by a big machine gun, I think, because they couldn't kill him any other way. But they are killed. We don't know how. But the scriptures tell us that their bodies, and in the Greek, it's called their carcasses. Do we ever call one of our deceased friends or relatives, their bodies, their carcass? No. We don't, do we? Look how demeaning they felt about even the dead bodies of these men. Carcasses. And it says their carcasses will lie in the public square of the great city. Whenever the scriptures speak of the great city, what are we talking about?
Jerusalem.
Whenever the scriptures say north, south, east, or west, it's not talking about Oklahoma City. When the scriptures talk about anything being north, north of what?
Jerusalem.
Jerusalem is always the reference point. So when you read Ezekiel 38 about that terrible Gog and Magog battle, and it says in the north of Jerusalem. So we always have to keep that in mind too when we talk about understanding the scriptures. When it gives you a direction, it's always in reference to the city of Jerusalem. So here we have, their carcasses will lie in the public square of the great city. And what's the city?
Jerusalem.
Can you imagine these bodies lying out there in the square of the city? And this city, Jerusalem, is figuratively, and that means spiritually, it is called what?
Sodom.
Now you all know about Sodom and Gomorrah, don't you? What do you know about Sodom and Gomorrah? What?
It was burned up.
It was burned up. But that's not why it's figuratively called Sodom here. Why would it be called Sodom?
Full of sin.
What?
Corruption.
It's sexual perversion. It's abhorrence of anything godly. In fact, is when Abraham's nephew Lot went into the town of Sodom, these men tried to take his daughters to molest them. And then they tried to take Lot. And then they tried to take angels. They were perverted in their sexual behavior. So here we're finding that this great city, the city of God, is spiritually what? Sodom. That's where we get the word sodomite. I mean, it's a dreadful picture, isn't it? So it's spiritually called Sodom. And it's also spiritually called Egypt. All throughout the prophets in the Old Testament, God tells his people, don't go back to where?
Egypt.
He's always saying that. Don't go back to Egypt. Now, they didn't have to physically go back to Egypt to go back to Egypt. They could go back to Egypt spiritually. And when you go back to Egypt spiritually, you are looking at bondage. You are looking at a nation that rebels against God. You're looking at a nation that is anti-Semitic, anti-Jewish. To this very day, it's anti-Semitic. So it says that, and we're going to find in the book of Revelation, that Egypt is, the anti-Jews is so strong right here in the city of Jerusalem. So he said, they lie in the public square of the great city Jerusalem, which is spiritually called what?
Sodom
and Egypt. And just in case you're not sure what city this is, it's the city where they crucified their Lord. What a sad definition of God's holy city, isn't it? So, Jerusalem is God's holy city. Sodom, this is letter C, I think, on your paper. Number two, letter C. Sodom is figuratively, spiritually called Sodom. Sodom is symbolic of moral decadence and sexual perversion. And God destroyed that city. And you'll find that if you want to read it in Genesis 19. Egypt is symbolic of the world in its rebellion and in its pride and in its anti-Semitism. And you'll find that, of course, in Exodus. So, during the tribulation, this is what we're referring to here. All of chapter 11 is telling us this is what's going to happen during the tribulation, during the time of these two witnesses, Jerusalem, which is God's holy city. And you know what the scriptures tell us? God selected Jerusalem to be his holy city. He selected Jerusalem where the temple would reside because he would come there to meet his people. It was this holy city, a beautiful city. It's the city that God chose. It will be considered as polluted and worldly as Sodom. Now, what do you think of that? Isn't that a terrible description? And it will be considered, this is Jerusalem now during the tribulation, it will be considered as rebellious and proud and anti-Semitic as Egypt. So let's look at our notes on number two at the top of 197. The world hated the two what?
Witnesses.
And why did they hate them? Because of their testimony and their power. Letter A, what? Their bodies or their carcasses will lie in the public square of the great city, the city called what?
Jerusalem.
It figuratively, spiritually, is called
Sodom,
which is symbolic of moral decadence and sexual perversion. Letter D, and what is the other place that it's considered?
Egypt.
Spiritually, it's called Sodom, and spiritually, God looks at it as if it were Egypt, which is symbolic of rebellion, pride. God hates pride. We're going to learn that next week when we study about Satan. He hates pride, and it's anti-Semitic or anti-Jewish. And if we can't really understand what that city is, then remember it's the city of Jerusalem, where their Lord was what?
Crucified.
So during the great tribulation, Jerusalem will be considered polluted and worldly as what?
Sodom.
And rebellious and proud and anti-Jewish as what?
Egypt.
Okay. Now let's look at the curiosity of these people. I mean, here we have these dead men who've been prophesying for 3.5 years, lying in the public square of Jerusalem, and everybody looks on. For 3.5 days, this is verse 9, some from every people, tribe, language, and nation, that is the entire world, will gaze on their bodies. Not only the people who are in Jerusalem at that time will gaze on their bodies, but the entire world will be gazing at their bodies, and they will refuse them burial. One of the things about the Jewish culture is that you never let a dead body lie for very long. In fact, you want it buried that very day. And right here in this city, they're letting these dead bodies lie in the square for 3.5 days and refuse them burial. And is it possible today for this prophecy to be fulfilled? For the whole world to watch these dead bodies?
Yes.
How is it possible today?
Television.
Television, satellites. If you're there, you can just take your cell phone, can't you? Tell us about that. Take your telephone and what would you do? Send it to the whole world, couldn't you? To every person you know. And you can send a live video if you want to. Wow. Okay. It is possible today. 60 years ago, my grandfather was still preaching. And he would have said when he read this passage that we don't know how this is going to be possible. You know? They didn't know how it would be possible. And it was only 60 years ago, and this was when I was somewhat of a young woman, that the first war ever put on television for the world to see. What war was that?
The
Vietnam War. Do you remember that? People have said that one of the main reasons that we had such hate and we wanted to get rid of the Vietnam War is because we'd never seen war like that. If we had been able to televise the Civil War with the thousands and thousands and thousands of people dead on a battlefield, they probably would have stopped it much earlier, wouldn't they have? So this is the first time, just 60 years ago, that we actually saw what a battlefield looked like. And then you could see what's happening in Jerusalem with your cell phones. So that was the Vietnam War. Today we have satellites, we have cell phones, we have any way that we can watch what's happening anywhere in the world at any moment. Number three in your book, on your notes, morbid curiosity. Morbid means dreadful. For 3.5, how many what? 3.5 what?
Days.
Some from every people, tribe, language, and nation. The scriptures in Revelation over and over and over again talk about people from every tribe, every people, every language, and every nation. That's indicative of the fact that it's the whole world. So the entire world will what?
Gaze
on their bodies. How morbid is that? And refuse them what?
Burial.
Now let's look at their enemies as they see these dead carcasses lying out in the public square. The delight of their enemies. The inhabitants of the earth, this is verse 10, will gloat over them. And will celebrate by sending each other gifts. This is one of the ways that the Antichrist will try to make himself look like Christ. We celebrate the birth of Christ, don't we? By doing what? Sending gifts. And so here he's kind of mocking Jesus Christ here because they're not going to be sending gifts because of the birth of somebody, but because they have killed somebody. They're going to send each other gifts. The only mention of any joy in the book of Revelation is right here in this verse. That's the only time joy on earth is mentioned. There's joy mentioned in heaven throughout the passages, but this is the only one during the entire tribulation where we see rejoicing on earth. And what kind of rejoicing is this? It's demonic. It's demonic glee. I tried to think of as many words as I could to describe demonic glee. You think of some too. Insane. This is letter B on your notes. Insane. It would be insane to be so gleeful to see dead bodies, wouldn't it? And to send people gifts because we're celebrating. Insane glee. Horrid. Inhuman. Hellish. Y'all work so hard. Ghoulish. Sounds like Halloween, doesn't it? Ghoulish glee. It was unbounded, meaning it was just endless. You couldn't even bring it in. Unbounded delight at the death of God's witnesses. So let's fill that in on number number 4. And then the scriptures tell us why they hated these witnesses so much. Look at what the verse says. They hated them so much because these two witnesses tormented them with their words. When people bring to you your faults and your sins, it's not something we like, is it? When they bring it up to us, we don't want to hear it. And that's what's happening here. We don't want to hear about the God of justice and the God of judgment. So it's because these two prophets tormented those who live on the earth with their prophecies and their messages and their miracles. They tormented them. Do I have time to talk about how much time? I don't have time. Okay, listen carefully. Remember the martyrs in the book of, in chapter, I think it was the fifth seal, the martyrs in heaven who had been killed for their belief. And their question was, how long, Lord, are we going to have to put up with this? Well, God says, wait. Well, in this passage, we're going to see the vindication that these witnesses experienced. The vindication by God. And so that will be the rest of our lesson for next week. I'm so sorry, I can't ever get done. Any questions? All right.
I have one.
Yes, ma'am.
When I read in Exodus, it was Aaron that threw down his staff and the other two swallowed him up. But we put Moses in them, the miracle. Does it matter?
No, because that was Aaron's miracle. Okay. But Moses is the one who brought plagues upon Egypt.
Okay.
And that's the difference here. Okay? Yes, ma'am.
My sign-up sheet.
The sign-up sheet. Where is the sign-up sheet for our Christmas breakfast? Oh, way back there with Jerry. Thank you, Jerry. All right, let's pray. Thank you, Father, for your word. Thank you that you told us these things so that we can know and we can share with people and that we can know that the time is near. And we thank you, Father, that you have given us hope, our great hope. Is that you're coming back for us very, very soon. And we look forward to that and we say, come, Lord Jesus. But until then, we will stand on the truth of your crucifixion. We stand on the truth of your burial and your resurrection and your ascension. And oh, we stand on the truth that you're coming back again. We thank you for that, Father. We give you all the glory and we exalt your Son, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Thank you for letting me be your teacher.